You're listening to KPFT HD1 90.1 on your dial. We are Pacifica Network Radio Station. It's time for Songwriter Studio. I'm your host, Tom Tranchilla, and we are in the Songbrush Studios this week. Happy Easter to all. I'd like to big thanks to Lloyd Daniel for letting us use his studio for this pre-record on this holiday. It is my real pleasure to bring back to the show Tom Ball from Tom Ball and Kenny Salton. Tom Ball with a brand spanking new solo guitar album, Autumn Guitar. Tom, thank you so much for joining us for an hour on Songwriter Studio.
Oh, it's my pleasure, man. It's always good to hear your voice, Tom.
Absolutely. I got turned on to your music. You know the story, probably close to 25 years ago. I used to play with...
That might have been out in Kerrville.
I got turned on to your music prior to that. You did some clinics out in California with my old partner, Dr. Gary Corsi, who came back with several of your CDs, and we just immediately fell in love with your music and couldn't quit laughing, and I've turned on countless people to your music since. And yes, after that, Kerrville.
I certainly appreciate that. Thanks. Thanks for helping us spread the word.
Hands down, the best harmonica player in the United States and probably on the planet. The harp players I've met over the years all agree that you're number one. You're the best.
Well, I sure appreciate that. I'm not sure if that's true, but it sure sounds good. Well,
I know some of your influences, and I think you've surpassed them all. But you and Kenny have been playing together for, I guess, what, 45 years or something like that?
Yeah, almost. It's like a 43, 44, something like that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we met up here in Santa Barbara back in about very early 1979. We started playing together out here. One thing led to another, and we're still playing together. It's still a lot of fun for both of us. And, you know, it beats working for a living, I'll tell you that.
You did tell me you're still performing every Sunday at Cold Springs Tavern.
We are, unless we have something better. I mean, they basically told us about 40 years ago, they just said, you've got all the Sundays. If you have a tour or something or a festival or something that pays more money, that's fine. Just, you know, give us 2-3 weeks notice so we can get a replacement. But unless you are somewhere else, you've got all the Sundays. So that's been a tradition now for, 35 years, I suppose. It's an old stagecoach stop from about the 1860s, log cabin, original. They tell me it's the oldest continuously operating restaurant in California, and it's in the middle of nowhere. So there's no neighbors. It's not, you're in the middle of the mountains. It feels like you're in Kentucky or Tennessee or somewhere than, Santa Barbara. It's really great spot. Good. Everybody shows up there. I mean, you get students, you get Hells Angels, you get cowboys, you get, wealthy folks driving Ferraris, and you get it's just a real cross section. So it's great people watching, students, dogs, kids. It's fun.
Tourists.
Yeah, a lot of tourists from Europe. I suspect it must be written up in, like the Swedish Fodor's Guide or whatever the equivalent is over there, because we hear a lot of languages. A lot of people show up from Europe. And that's good for us because, they all want to take a little souvenir home with them. So hopefully they'll buy one of our CDs. So it works out well.
Having experienced the Cold Springs Tavern one afternoon, my wife and I were out in the Santa Barbara area and came out to watch your show. And you're just, I had seen you before at the Kerrville Festival, but something about the setting of the Cold Springs and you guys sitting on your stools out there on the front, just magical.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah, it's really a lot of fun. We really enjoy it. We'll be back up there this Sunday.
Tom, you've got a brand spanking new album, and a lot of people that listen to music do not know what a great guitar player you really are. And is this, your third or fourth solo album? I know you've got numerous.
It's my fifth, actually.
Your fifth solo guitar album.
Yeah. Guitar was my first instrument, so I learned that, long before I picked up the harmonica. And, the only reason I picked up harmonica, I think, is this is sort of the folk boom, and you had people that were playing guitar and singing folk songs, and they had harmonica with a rack, early Bob Dylan and Eric Anderson, Doc Watts, and, Donovan, of course, when he came along. And so, I picked up the harmonica. Well, I heard an interview with Billy Joel the other day, and he he said the first time he saw Dylan, he felt sorry for him because he thought he'd been in a car accident because he thought that harmonica rack was a neck brace. But then he figured out what it was, and I made a little neck thing out of a coat hanger. I didn't know that they were commercially made, you know. So I just made a little harmonica holder and started trying to play along. And then one day I heard Sonny Terry on the radio and went, whoa, that's a whole different bag, you know. I didn't realize people could do that with a harmonica. So I got more and more involved. And I think what happened is during my younger years in high school and such, everybody played guitar. There was a lot of real good players, good young players, but hardly anybody in Los Angeles, among my age group at least, was playing blues harmonica. So I got a lot concentrating a little bit more on that. But the guitar's always been in the back burner, and I've done, five solo guitar records.
Well, speaking of Sonny Terry, if I'm not mistaken, don't you share the same birthday?
We do, yeah, October 24th, yeah. Different years, though.
I'll tell you what, your new album is just fantastic, Autumn Guitar. And you took a lot of the old classic songs from movie themes and stuff like that, including an Andrew York and a Leonard Bernstein, and just really... put your touch to it, Tom. It's nothing but you and a guitar, the crystal clear recording. Hands off to the engineer that put this project and did your recording and mixing, because it is superb.
Well, thank you. Yeah, this is David West, and he's done the last three solo guitar records that I've done. But I've known David even longer than I've known Kenny. I met David in Santa Barbara. As soon as I moved to town, he was playing guitar and all the other string instruments with a sort of bluegrass/newgrass band called the Cache Valley Drifters. They had a record deal with Flying Fish and made several albums for them. And they were touring all over the place. And I came to know him very well. He's a very close friend. But for the last 35 years or so, he's also had a recording studio. And he's engineered hundreds and hundreds of records. In fact, I've played with him on over 100 CDs. Mostly on harmonica, but he's produced just tons of stuff. He's a brilliant guy, and he knows exactly what he's doing. He knows how to record guitar. Fortunately, I have a real good sounding guitar, so you know, we're starting off with a nice instrument, and he knows just what mics to use and where to put them. And he's brilliant. I really love working with David. He's a great Studio Z, it's called, in Santa Barbara, David West.
And I'm sure it was his connection that got you with the Flying Fish label as well.
Well, it was, really. I mean, we were with Kicking Mule at the time, and that was okay. But Flying Fish had a little better distribution, and David introduced us to the guys at Fish. And originally they said, well, you have to tour more. Once you start touring more, you know, we'll sign you because we like your music. So what happened is every time I'd go, like, to New Orleans on vacation with my wife or something, I'd send the postcards. They were touring, you know, we're out here in New Orleans, and we'd send them all these postcards. I'd send these postcards to my friends that lived in Canada and stuff and say, hey, can you resend this, you know, so it'll have a Canadian postmark on it. Like, we're touring Canada, you know. And finally, after about 2 years of this, Bruce Kaplan just finally said, you guys aren't going to quit, are you? And we said, no. And so he gave up. He said, okay, we'll sign you. And so we ended up doing four albums for them. Which probably would have been more albums, but Bruce unexpectedly got sick and passed away really young, some sort of meningitis thing. And so the label was sold to Rounder. We did one more record as Flying Fish, but it was owned by Rounder. So, you know, one thing leads to another. The Kicking Mule label got sold to Fantasy, and then Fantasy got sold to Concord. And Flying Fish got sold to Rounder. Rounder got sold to Concord. So now Concord got sold to some big hedge fund. So
they're in trouble
half
now.
Half of all the recording, you know, half of all the blues and bluegrass and folk music and Americana and Celtic music is all owned by this hedge fund, and they don't have a clue what to do with it. I don't know what's going to happen to our records. Of course, nobody buys records anymore, so I guess it doesn't really matter. But it was a good time bringing those records out, and I value our relationship with Flying Fish. But nowadays, it's a lot tougher, I think, for young people trying to break into the so-called music business.
If you're just tuning in, Tom Ball's our guest on Songwriter Studio, and we're going to be featuring song off his brand spanking new album, Autumn Guitar. But before we jump into that, Tom, I talked to you before the show. I wanted to feature a couple of songs with you and Kenny off Filthy Rich. All talk and no action. This has got a little hidden meaning to some of my friends that hang out at Kerrville lyrically, and we're going to start that out. Tell the folks a little bit about this opening track, All Talk and No Action.
Back in the 80s, Kenny and I used to play at a club in Montecito called The Grill. And, well, this was the 80s, right? And the gig started at 10:30 at night, ended at 2 in the morning. And you're in Montecito, so, you know, there's a lot of money around, and it was the 1980s, and it was late at night. And as you can imagine, a lot of people were doing a lot of talking, real fast talking. So we had to make up this song as revenge, you know, all talk and no action. And you know, we used to sing it at the crowd, and it was our revenge. But of course, it kind of backfired on us because nobody was listening, and nobody could hear that we were singing this revenge tune at him. So, but we recorded it anyway.
From the album Filthy Rich, this is Tom Ball and Kenny Sultan, All Talk and No Action.
Well, you've been flapping your trap ever since you were little. You must have been vaccinated with a phonograph needle. You're all talk and no action. Everywhere in the world you go, well, you got a head like a brick, a mouth like a radio. Well, you might stop talking on the day that you choke. If silence is golden, then you must be broke. You're all talk and no action. Everywhere in the world you go, well, you got a head like a brick and a mouth like a radio. Some plugs and stick them in my ears. You sound like a convention of tobacco auctioneers. You're all talking no action. Everywhere in this world you go, well, you got a head like a brick, a mouth like a radio. Talks, and I know it ain't no lie, 'cause every time I get some, it tells me goodbye. It's all talk and no action. Yes, everywhere in the world I go, well, you got a head like a brick, a mouth like a radio. Yes, if you don't stop blabbing, Lord, down the road I go.
Tom Ball, Kenny Sultan, All Talk and No Action. What a great song. Been a while since you've recorded that, but it's still fresh, new, and just hilarious.
Yeah, it was good fun making those records.
I'll tell you, Tom, this whole album, when I first received it years ago, it's just so good from beginning to end. I just played it over and over again, and it's one gut-busting, laughing song after another, with some serious blues, let me add. So before we jump into the brand new record, Autumn Guitar, I want to play one more track off this album, and that is the title track, Filthy Rich. And I think in our last interview, we may have featured this song, and I always got a kick out of the tuba. You brought in Dean Dobbs for this. Talk a little bit about that.
Well, you know, we had done a gig on 4th of July that year, and the other band was a sort of a marching band, and they were doing... as expected on July 4th, they were doing a lot of patriotic songs, and it was all horns. And we heard this guy, Dean, you know, playing the tuba, and it was, he blew our minds. I mean, it was so great to have that bass, you know, in there, but have it be a horn bass. So, you know, we asked him if he'd be interested in recording with us at one point, and he said, sure. So it turned out he lives, maybe 75 miles south of here. So we did this recording session in Carpinteria over at Jim Messina's place. And Dean throws a tuba in the back of his pickup truck and drives up on the coast highway, you know, for an hour and a half. And when he gets up there, you know, the tuba is like ice cold. He says, well, you know, I'm going to have to warm up for a moment. And he pulls the tuba out and he starts honking on it. And it just sounded horrible. I mean, it didn't sound anything like a horn. It just was, it sounded like a traffic jam on the freeway, you know. And what we didn't realize is it literally needed to warm up. You know, it had gotten real cold in the back of this truck. And I guess there's a reaction, you know, with the metal, whatever kind of brass they use on a tuba. I don't know. But once it got warmed up, of course, he plays great and sounded great and recorded great. But it took a while to get that thing warmed up. So if you're going to play tuba, don't put it in the back of a pickup truck. That's all I can think.
Sounded so good, it turned out to be the title track of the album. This is Tom Ball, Kenny Sultan, the title track of Filthy Rich.
A beautiful chick and get respect wherever I go. I wanna be rolling in dough. I want somebody give me $1 million in cash. Well, I'm tired of being poor white trash. Don't wanna eat no more cans of beans. I wanna be a man of means. I wanna smoke cigars and play guitars and ride around in fancy cars and eat breakfast in bed. Well, overweight and feeling great every morning, sleeping late. If I only had the bread, you know, won't somebody answer my prayer and make me a millionaire? I'll make time with any woman I choose. I wanna be Howard Hughes. And play guitars and ride around in fancy cars and eat breakfast in bed. Well, overweight and feeling great every morning, sleeping late. If I only had the bread, you know, well, I'd like to have a big amount tucked away in my bank account. Well, I'd be one happy son of a bitch if somebody would make me rich. Give me a penny, Benny, I want some dough, Joe. Give me some bread, Fred, I want some Jing Bing. Well, I wanna be a filthy rich.
Tom Ball, Kenny Sultan, the title track, Filthy Rich. Little harmonic at the end there, and what a tuba job that was.
Yeah, it's fun to have a tuba.
Tom, you're all over the map, but your harp work, you're from the lower registers to the upper registers in that song, and any note you could hit, you were hitting it in that. You are such a professional, I'll tell you.
Thank you, Tom. I always have fun with it, you know. It's a fun instrument. You can carry it around with you, you know. You don't need to have a big old truck to drive your drum kit around. All you need is a harp. You
know? Yeah, a pocket to put it in.
That's it.
Tom, your brand new album, we've been talking about it now for about 20 minutes, 25 minutes. I think it's time we dived into Autumn Guitar. What a great record this is. Totally different from what you and Kenny do. This is more of a classical slash I don't know how to describe the genre other than acoustic guitar. And why don't you let the listening audience know your how you set this up, which songs you decided to choose for this recording. And go ahead. Mic is yours.
Well, I think what happened is I had already done 4 solo guitar records. I wasn't really planning on doing another one. But what happens is sometimes, you know, you work up an arrangement of a song and you like the arrangement, but it's kind of difficult technically. And so I start thinking, well, I better record this because if I don't play this every day, I'm going to lose it, right? So I better record it just so I can learn it back from my own recording 10 years down the road. So I would go into David's studio every now and then, about once a year, and record a song. And finally, after about 8 years, I realized, man, I got more than half an album here. I might as well just finish this up and bring it out. So I went digging around and I found some tunes that were originally written for classical guitar, but they sounded good on steel strings. It really rang, you know. And I've always been a big fan of Ennio Morricone's music. He's a phenomenal composer, wrote a lot of film scores. So I dug up a few of his tunes, and one by Andrew York, one by a great Irish guitar player named Pat Coldrick, and various other sources, and you know, just went in and recorded them one by one until I finally had enough to fill up a CD and went ahead and brought it out.
It sounds to me like you may have used a drop D tuning in this. Am I correct or not?
Yes, quite a lot of these songs. I would say close to half of the songs on this are in drop D, which is, for those of you who don't play guitar, it's just regular tuning except for the bass string is tuned 2 half steps flat from E down to D. There's a couple other songs on here that are in open tunings, but most of them are either in drop D or in standard. I think there's maybe 2 or 3 others that are in different tunings than that. I can't remember offhand. There's 15 songs on the album.
It's a long record. All the songs were very specifically placed. I like how you arranged the order of these songs. And I think the one song that stuck out to me is possible altered tuning other than drop D. I might be wrong. Somewhere, A Place for Us. This is the Leonard Bernstein song. Do you recall the tuning you used on that?
I think it's in drop D.
It could be. Let's start out with Home, and we'll work on it.
Home is in drop D. I know that. And I don't know. I'd have to look it up here. I've got the paperwork in front of me. I'll be able to tell you what. As we listen to the tune, I'll tell you what tunings they're all in.
From the brand-new release, Tom Ball, Autumn Guitar, the opening track, Andrew York's Home.
Thank you.
from the album Autumn Guitar, a tremendous recording of Andrew York's Home. This is Tom Ball. Tom, it just blows me away, the clarity of the acoustic recording. It's stunning. Do you recall the mics used in this recording?
Yeah, David set me up with two Neumann KM-184s, and they were in what he calls an XY pattern. They sort of crisscross, but not exactly like an X pattern. If I remember right, one of them is aimed toward the neck, and the other one's aimed toward the lower neck where it goes over the body, but not as far down as, say, the sound hole. And then he ran those mics through a Neve preamp, and then he also put a room mic in the back of the room, about 4 feet behind me and kind of above my head. This was a AKG 451, and he ran that through a four-cell preamp and then mixed them all together. There's no compression. There's no EQ or anything. It's just flat, you know. And then when it was mastered, of course, they added a bit of reverb to it. But it's a good sounding room, and David uses great mics, and he's got good ears, and it doesn't hurt that my little Gibson sounds real good. It records real well. It's an interesting guitar. It used to be a four string guitar, and I broke the neck off and took it to Jim Lombard here in town, and he converted it to a six string. So it's got a body from 1936 and a neck from 1981. It's not a loud guitar. You know, if you're sitting around a kitchen jamming with people and somebody's got a dreadnought, you know, you just get buried. It's not a loud guitar, but it records beautifully. It's real responsive in the studio. And that's the only guitar I've used since 1981. It's just, that's the one. I'm a one guitar guy.
You would be hard pressed to beat the quality of that recording. Lloyd, did you make notes of all those mics he was using? Our engineer, he's got a big smile on his face back here. That's quite... You know, I knew you had converted your 36 Gibson. I wasn't aware. It was a four-string originally. This wasn't a tenor guitar, was it? Was it just a four-string? Go ahead.
I was... At the time that I bought that guitar, I thought all four-string guitars were just called tenor guitars. I didn't realize there's different kinds of four-string guitars. And apparently Gibson was making two in the mid-30s, one that they called a tenor guitar and one that they called a plectrum guitar. And the bodies were the same, and the necks were pretty much the same, except for the scale length was different. And so the bridge was in a different spot. And so if you had a tenor guitar, and tried to convert it to six strings, it'd be a lot more problematic because you have to move where the bridge is in order to compensate for the extended scale length between the nut and the saddle of the bridge. I happen to have bought a plectrum guitar without knowing it, because they're not marked on the inside, so you don't have the advantage of, you know, reading on the inside just what style of guitar it is. But I bought it, and then it looked to me like the bridge was in the right spot to be able to convert it, and it turned out I was right. But I didn't realize that there was more than one kind of. I just thought all four-string guitars were called tenor guitars. But this one converted real well. The bridge was in the right spot, and Jim Lombard made the neck and fingerboard and the new headstock. And then, he had to make a new bridge and a saddle. And it was a long project. And neither one of us knew whether it was going to sound any good. You know, there's no way to tell. There was times when I was scratching my head going, you know, I'm pumping a lot of money and Jim's pumping a lot of time into this project, and we have no clue whether it's going to sound any good. Well, it ended up sounding great, and we were both very happily surprised. It sounded wonderful. So that's been my guitar of choice all this time.
Of course, you're risking the bracing, whether or not it supports the bridge with the extra string strength. So apparently it all worked out.
It did. There's the plectrum guitar was only slightly less solidly braced, and that's probably a good thing, because in the 30s Gibson tended to overbrace their guitars. They didn't want to have to do any warranty work, so they put in this massive bracing. It was like the underside of the Brooklyn Bridge, you know. So the fact that the four string plectrum guitar had slightly less bracing worked in my favor, really.
It adds to the resonance.
Yeah.
Tom, let's jump into the next track. This is probably, if not my favorite, one of my top three, four tracks off the record, Somewhere, A Place for Us. Of course, this is from West Side Story and recorded by Barbra Streisand and a slew of other singers. But you have just mastered this song, Somewhere, A Place for Us, Leonard Bernstein's classic. Go ahead, give the listening audience a little heads up on your preparation for the arrangement.
I always enjoyed the song. but it's not the kind of song I would sing, you know. But I liked the chord progression. I liked the way it sounded. And so now that I think about it, I think this is in standard tuning. I don't think there's anything odd about it. But it was just one of those tunes I had to mess around with until I could come up with an arrangement. And, you know, it took a while, but I did. I like it.
From the brand new album, Autumn Guitar, Tom Ball, this is Somewhere, a Place for Us. Incredible recording, just a wonderful arrangement of Leonard Bernstein's Somewhere, a Place for Us. Tom Ball off the brand new album, Autumn Guitar. Wow.
Thanks, Tom. Yeah, that was a fun one.
Yeah, I'll tell you, the way you pause and leave your open air in the song, and it's a perfect way for the listener to contemplate the notes you're playing, and for a guitar player, really can appreciate what you've done with the song. My compliments.
Well, thank you. I think some of that, of course, comes, you know, when I was 25, I wanted to play as fast as I could, you know, show off. And then as you get older, you start getting more arthritic. And then also, hopefully, you start getting better, having better taste, and start realizing that the empty spaces are just as important, if not more important, than the notes. And I think I learned that the more I listened to the guitarists that I had really admire, you know, the especially the steel string players, guys like, you know, Ry Cooder and David Lindley, and, you know, those guys, it's what they don't play that sometimes it really brings you to the emotional high point of the piece, you know. And it's something you learn, I think, as you age, you know, at least hopefully.
No, I agree 100%. Everything you said was correct, and the open spaces. And it's not something in my early years of playing guitar I understood, the importance of the open space. And you made it clear in this song, and you let the song breathe, and it just turned into pure beauty. I wanted to talk Tom, about Ennio Morricone. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing his name correctly, the Italian composer. He's been on hundreds and hundreds of scores of cinema, television, etc. You chose to record several of his songs on this record. All are excellent. And we've got Love Affair queued up right now. Tell us a little bit about that.
Oh, that's a nice one. Yeah, he did. I did a lot of his tunes. Also, I did a solo guitar record that was all taken from films. It's called Music from Films. And I ended up using a lot of Ennio Morricone stuff because he's sort of known as he writes, you know, beautiful melodies and with a lot of suspensions and just great sounding stuff. But on the other hand, he also is known as sort of a novelty, kind of a kitsch composer. You know, he did all the background music for all the spaghetti westerns, you know, Clint Eastwood tunes, those kind of tunes. So he would do all that stuff too. And then right after that, he'd play just this tear-jerking, beautifully symphonic, these pieces that, I don't know, I just love the way he composes. He was my favorite. And he's done so much. I mean, every time I go back to, you know, a great film and realize, God, that's another one that Morricone scored. He was so prolific. I would recommend to anybody to go onto YouTube and dig him up. And, you know, because there's a lot of stuff on YouTube of him actually conducting orchestras, playing his material. And it's wonderful stuff. So, yeah, he's one of my heroes.
Let's listen to that track right now. Love Affair. Ennio Morricone, off the brand new album, Autumn Guitar. This is Tom Ball. Ennio Morricone, Tom Ball's arrangement, Love Affair, off his brand new album, Autumn Guitar. Tom, while that was playing, Lloyd and I were discussing the clarity of the recording. It's stunning. Between your guitar work and the mic that the engineer used, it's incredible.
Well, thanks. I'm sure David will appreciate hearing that too. He works hard to make those guitars sound good. You know, it does sound really great. And also the guy that mastered it, his name is Emmett Sargent. He's brilliant. And he's got great ears too. So it was a group effort. Came out all right.
The record, is it available for downloads? What's the status on it right now?
You know, it's not available for downloads, and it's not available in in stores either. Really, the only way anybody could get one would be to send me an email, and I'll be happy to to send one through the mail, or else come to a gig. I'm bringing them to gigs, but I'm purposely not selling them in any stores. There's no code on the thing. So, you know, it can't be sold in stores. It's a limited pressing, hardly anywhere made. So I'm just bringing them with me to gigs and selling them through the mail. But folks could go to my website. It's just tomball.us. I tried to get tomball.com, but of course that was already taken up by your town. Tomball. So it's tomball.us.
We're sitting here. The Songbrush Studios is located in Tomball, Texas, by the way.
That's perfect.
Purely coincidental. So,
I love it.
Tom, this is a spectacular new record. I love it. I think this would be excellent background at a party, at about any event where you want good, clean, clear background, beautiful written, beautiful played songs. Highly recommend this record. If anyone wants to purchase it, it is available. You're going to have to go direct through Tom Ball. So let's talk about Deborah's Theme, the next track we've got queued up.
Well, Deborah's Theme, that's another Ennio Morricone tune, and it comes from a movie that was a pretty old movie directed by Sergio Leone. It's a crime saga. It was called Once Upon a Time in America. I don't know if you remember this film. Robert De Niro was in it, and James Woods and Elizabeth McGovern. And it was basically Joe Pesci. It was basically kind of a Godfather type of movie about crime in the 20s, except for instead of it being the Italian mobsters, it was the Jewish mobsters. And so it's a quite interesting film. It lasts about 5 hours. It's there's a shorter version of it, but the shorter version I don't really like very much. But the longer version is terrific if you have the patience for it. And the central female character is named Deborah, and she's played by Elizabeth McGovern. And this is the theme that keeps coming up every time she appears in the movie. So it's just called Deborah's Theme from Once Upon a Time in America.
Let's listen to this track right now. Off the brand new Tom Ball album, Autumn Guitar, this is Deborah's Theme. From the brand new album, Autumn Guitar, beautiful rendition of the theme song, Deborah's Theme. Tom, that was wonderful. I love your choice of placement of harmonics through these songs, too. You're so, so tasteful.
Thanks, man. I appreciate it.
you're just tuning in, Tom Ball's been our guest on Songwriter Studio. We've got a little bit of time left, featuring songs off of his brand new album, Autumn Guitar, as well as some of his older material with his music partner, Kenny Sultan. I'm going to let you make the call. We're going to spin the next song, either Too Much Fun by Bill Kirchin, of course, penned, and or My Gal, both off the album Too Much Fun. And why don't you make the shot on this? What would you like us to air next?
How about My Gal?
My Gal it is.
Yeah, because that one's a little bit raggier, and it gives Kenny a chance to show off some fancier picking. You know, Kenny, of course, is a brilliant guitar player, so it's always fun working with him. And yeah, that'd be great. That'd be great.
I've got a copy of West Coast Blues, one of Kenny's solo albums he released years ago. Just to talk about a brilliant record.
Yeah.
That is an excellent record for those people that want to listen to or learn some great ragtime. Kenny Sultan's the man.
Yep.
You got some great fiddle work on My Gal, too. Who do you have playing fiddle on this track?
Geez, I can't remember. It's either Byron Berline or Joe Craven. Now, remind me, which album is this from?
I'm under the assumption that it came off of Too Much Fun, so whichever album that fiddle player was. Let's listen to that track right now. Maybe you can tell by listening to him.
Okay, it's one or the other.
Off the album Too Much Fun, this is My Gal, Tom Ball, Kenny Sultan.
Well, a rich gal, she rides in an automobile. A poor gal will do quite the same. But my gal drive an old hay wagon, you know she's getting there just the same. And I'll be there in the morning if I live. And I'll be there in the morning if I don't get killed. If I never no more see you again, you know, be sure to remember me. Well, a rich gal, she'll beat you, she'll bop you with a stick. A poor gal will do quite the same. But my gal, get a rusty razor and run you all over town. You know, she's raising hell just the same. And I'll be there in the morning if I live. Well, I'll be there in the morning if I don't get killed. If I never no more see you again, you know, be sure to remember me. Good old whiskey, and a poor gal will drink quite the same. But my gal, she drinks tidy bowl, you know, she's getting drunk just the same. And I'll be there in the morning if I live.
If I live.
And I'll be there in the morning if I don't get killed.
Don't get killed.
And if I never no more see you again, you know, be sure to remember me. She'll kiss you mighty sweet. A poor gal will kiss quite the same. But my gal spit back at you, she'll slobber all over your face. You know she's loving me just the same. And I'll be there in the morning if I live.
If I live.
And I'll be there in the morning if I don't get killed.
Don't get killed.
Well, if I never no more see you again, you know, be sure to remember.
If I had to make a list of the 10 greatest rags ever recorded, My Gal would be on top of that list.
Oh, man.
Tom, yeah, you got the fiddle playing, the guitar playing, the harp playing. Just everything was just so tight. It's definitely one of the great ragtime tunes ever recorded. My compliments.
Oh, thank you, my friend. And it is Byron Berline on fiddle.
There you go.
I recognize Byron's style. He was such a gifted guy and such a good friend of ours for a long, long time. He passed away about a year ago. But
oh, my gosh. I wasn't aware of that.
We miss him. He's a wonderful, wonderful player. That was recorded in Carpinteria. Yeah, way back in the day. So we had fun with it.
Well, we've had fun doing this last 58-minute interview with you, Tom. It's always a pleasure to talk to you. You're such a great interview, and the music is always top-notch.
Well, thank you, sir. Thank you, Lloyd, too. We appreciate it.
Yeah, he's been in there bopping his head up and down with every track. So.
All right. Well, thanks again for having me back, Tom. And give my best to Diana, and good luck with the show. And keep on rolling, man. Thanks for having me.
The new album is Autumn Guitar, Tom Ball. Go to his website and give it a shout out. Send him an email. Tell him you want a copy of this. It's just an excellent record. I can't rave about it as much. And please get back to the Kerrville Music Festival. Deb Rouse is now the new director out there, so we'll put in a word for you. Try to bring you back to the festival. Your live show with Kenny is second to none. It's always one of the highlights of the festival. So
love to get back out there. Yeah, that's a fun festival.
I'll put a bug in Deb's ear, see if we can't get you back out there. And we're going to go out with the last track off the record, Lament. Why don't you give the listening audience a little heads up on this, and we're going to go out with it.
Oh, yeah. This track was written by an Irishman named Pat Coldrick, who's a classical guitar player and composer. Wonderful guy. You ought to look him up on YouTube. And I really like this song, Lament.
Thanks again for spending a little time with us in Songwriter Studio.
My pleasure.
Listening audience, please stick around. Up next, Pete Little with Irish Airs. And see you next week.